from the net. Blogs, websites, podcasts, to this place,
the Mainframe Chronicle. Our format, podcasters, to analyze and discuss, to discuss the shows we love.
Their strengths and flaws.
We discuss them until our jaws ache.
Software pirates. This is bad. This is very bad.
Megabyte hit a delete command in the mask, just like you said. Only he didn't know because I should have copied and pasted the truth from the start.
I am the Crimson Bino.
So many moods. So little time.
Be careful, young Enzo. Remember that anything worthwhile takes time.
Aye, sir! Aye, aye!
What we have here is a failure to network.
Well, get to work, you two. I don't keep you around for your brains, now do I?
No, sir! Not our brains! Absolutely not!
The monkeys are restless, and my dog has fleas. Over.
This is gonna take millions and millions of nanoseconds! This might even take one whole second!
Doc, can you read me? Doc!
They say the listener lives outside the net.
And listens to podcasts.
No one knows for sure.
But we intend to find out. Mainframe Chronicle.
Hello and welcome back to Mainframe Chronicle podcast. As always, I'm Daniel Janes.
And I am Joey Morris.
And today we are finishing up season two of the 90s cartoon Reboot. But first, how are you doing, Joey?
I am doing fantastic. You know, my job's going well. I had that last time. I know I said that. We just had our evaluations, and I'm happy to say I passed with flying colors, so that was pretty cool. And I'm pretty good. Now, Dan, I know you have a couple new jobs. How are you doing?
Pretty good. Working at a UPS store, which isn't, you know, ideal, but it pays money, and it's a good environment. And I just got a job at Home Depot as a cashier. Later today to fill out the paperwork and stuff. So even more money to go to student loans.
Now, doesn't UPS give benefits to their part-time employees?
They do, but I'm not with UPS. It's a UPS store. It's a locally owned business that just ships stuff out of Flagstaff.
That's a really good deal for a part-time job, but that's awesome.
Yeah. It pays the bills, so you know.
And you do don't you do sound on the side as well now?
Well, I'm in the pool for a guy who does production up here, and I have yet to be called, but if he needs an extra hand or two, then he'll give people a call as he needs them.
That's cool.
So yeah, it's good stuff.
Once you get called, I think you'll probably get called back again.
Yeah, and just gotta, you know, actually do stuff for them. Before we get into the episodes, we actually got some feedback today.
I know it might be kind of unprofessional, but I am ecstatic about this because, you know, I'm happy to do it just to rewatch Reboot and have a reason to do it. But now we know someone actually has listened to it and, you know, spoiler alert, enjoys it. So yeah. I'm pretty excited.
Spoiler alert on the feedback. I love it. So, yeah, a young man named Carson M. sent us an email at mainframechronicle@gmail.com.
Of course, and you can always send emails to the exact same email.
Yes.
A little plug there.
You definitely should. So we can read it on the air like we are doing right about now. Carson M. said, I just left a 5-star iTunes review. great podcast. I've been enjoying your podcast the past 2 weeks. I've actually caught up on Reboot and your podcast to the newest episode. I wish you guys could watch them quicker, but it's understandable with your jobs slash personal lives. I also recommend posting the podcast on reddit.com/r/reboot to get more attention. Only criticism is I wish you guys could put more research into each show so listeners can get the most out of the show without having to read other websites. But I know you guys aren't perfect.
Yeah, and then Carson continued to say that he forgot to mention how he got into the show, which I think is pretty fascinating. I think, you know, to get into this show, I think there's a lot of different ways people have done that. So he said, like most people, he was in elementary school when watching the show the first time. He says that I think that I was into Reboot because it was a blend of video games and cartoons, two things that I loved. Now, rewatching this as an adult, I can more clearly understand the humor, the arcs, and the references. I remember it was the time before I had access to the internet, so I had no idea when or if the show would return after breaks. I was happy to see that they made a 4 seasons eventually, within large gaps of time, of course.
Yeah, and I replied explaining that, you know, we try to do enough research to make us sound knowledgeable. And then he replied back, about doing research, I think it's just me being picky over everyday little details slash references within the show of Reboot, which might be kind of insane to pay too much attention. I think it really just bothered me on the art episode because you guys missed some references to the art. Bothered me most mainly because I'm an art major. I understand there aren't enough hours in the day to research every little thing in the show. I guess the story arcs and characters are more important. I hope you get some new podcast episodes out soon, and good luck with Skype. So yeah, thanks Carson for all that great feedback. A couple of notes. Yeah, we try to do a lot of research as much as we can. The art one, there was just so many, and that if we had gone over every one, that episode probably would have been like 3 hours because there were many.
Yeah, no, and there was so many, and plus I would just be saying, you know, as not an art buff or someone who generally knows these things, I could pick out some of the main ones, but, you know, and I could find lists of the ones that I didn't recognize, but I wouldn't know anything about them, I wouldn't have any anecdotes about them or anything, so it would be kind of dry. So I think, you know, we just stuck to the ones that we knew, but, you know, that's very good criticism.
Yeah, so this I just thought of, Carson, if you wanted to go over all the extra art things that we missed, all the references, you can give us a call at 909-277-6907. So yeah, if you wanted to leave us a voicemail there, you could do so, and we'll edit it into the next show.
And that'd be awesome, because I'm sure you would have more information on those stuff than anything that I could research on, you know, quickly on the internet. So that would be incredible. I'd be all over that.
Exactly. My background's in theater, so I know a little bit about art, doing the research for sets and stuff. But, you know, I'm not going to be as knowledgeable as an art major, per se.
Oh, sure. And I'm a poli-sci major, so that means I'm qualified to do absolutely nothing except maybe do a podcast on Reboot. But
exactly.
You know, that's to be debated.
So just a couple other notes on Carson's feedback. He said he left a 5-star review on iTunes. Not to call him a liar, but iTunes has been treating me like crap recently. I just realized that pretty much all the stuff I put on iTunes is no longer working. So hopefully that'll be fixed soon. And otherwise, you're listening to this on the website, probably. So, that'll be fun.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah, technical difficulties, as always. Another final thing, thanks for the tip on posting on Reddit. I did that with all my other podcasts and got some extra boost in the page views. So, good call on that one.
I don't even use Reddit. I'm not even sure what that is.
It's just another website that links you to a bunch of other stuff.
No, well.
they call it the front page of the internet.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but it's essentially Google, but more categorized, if that makes sense.
And it's generally centered around entertainment, isn't it?
It's got everything.
Oh, does it?
Okay. Seems to be entertainment, but yeah. It's kind of a mix between a search engine and a social network.
That's fair. I'll have to look into it. Sounds pretty cool. Kevin Smith talks about it a lot. I just have never paid attention.
Yeah. Sweet. So, Joey, why don't you take us into episode 2.07?
So what is all this for?
We're testing a theory, Andrea. We think that a game retains the basic encryption of all active players when the user wins. It's called a saved game. So if a null is trapped in the game that created it, there's a chance, a slim chance, that the sprite will be recompiled. And of course, if we then win the game, the sprite would remain whole and in mainframe.
What he means is, the game that nullified the sprite can also bring it back.
That's what I said.
He said it better.
Thanks, Andrea.
All right, man. This episode is entitled Nullzilla, and I think if you've seen the episode, it's pretty clearly why. The original air date was December 27th, 1995. Just a little note there. I was 5 years old. How crazy is this that we're talking about this so much later? Anyway.
I had just turned six, over a month before that. Weird.
It's just insane. I still can't get over that sometimes. But anyway, the summary is something horrible comes through Hex's looking glass, mutating her into a black supervirus. The Nulls launch an offensive on her, creating a gigantic Null monster. So, Dan, what do you think of this episode?
It was all right. It was written by, and the story was by Susan Turner, who was a story designer and script supervisor for the show. Yeah, she wrote Andrea too, a bunch of other stuff as well. I wasn't completely overly impressed by it. It worked for me on the level that it was a setup for the next episode, but yes. Other than that, there wasn't a ton that was great about it.
No, I agree. I think the story was really I don't, kind of not forced, but just kind of it seemed to play on a lot of cliches, and it was heavy on like some of the references. Like if you really enjoyed the reference to the Power Rangers, and you probably really enjoyed the episode. But I think the story itself, when you're looking at it, just wasn't very developed, especially when you think about some of the heavy hitters we've had in season two and, you know, coming up specifically at the end. So when you're watching them, I mean, maybe by itself, but when you watch it in conjunction with the other episodes, I wasn't a huge fan.
Yeah, I did like the clip of Franken-Gnome, the Bride of Franken-Gnome that Hex was watching on Mike the TV at the beginning.
Yeah, that was really cool. I thought that was great.
And one of the best quotes from the episode comes from that, when the Franken-Gnome monster starts to be alive. The Franken-Gnome is like, "It's compiled! It's compiled!"
Which you, of course, have never... You don't have to have seen that movie to know that, you know, it's a reference to it's alive, it's alive. I mean, that's been parodied so many times, and it's awesome. I love it.
Exactly. Good stuff there.
I kind of like the whole back and forth between Hex and Mike the TV. I know it was really small and not integral to the storyline or anything, but they just... I mean, because he's kind of prone to hero worship, and she's kind of prone to being... worshipped, so I thought it worked pretty well. Like he called her the Highness and she called him Michael. It was just weird. We hadn't seen that before, I don't think.
Yeah, I really like when shows do that, take two characters that are never really seen together and then give them a scene.
Yeah,
and you get to see their interaction. It's one of those things where like you would never really think of seeing Hex and Mike together, but the way that they did it was really well done.
And Mike the TV has been becoming a pretty consistent character. So it's cool that they put him with, you know, one of the biggest villains of the entire series and just a casual conversation.
Yeah.
But right after that, you know, we got to start talking to Hack and Slash. Did you notice they had new voices?
I did. At least Hack. I was like, wow, that sounds like Rat Trap from Beast Wars. And interestingly enough, he's the guy who plays Optimus Primal in Beast Wars, Gary Chalk. Which,
oh, really?
Yeah, during my research for this episode, I came across a couple of Comic-Con type panels, and one of them had him in it, and he's just hilarious. He's a fantastic guy. I'm going to put links to those in the show notes at mainframechronicle.blogspot.com. So check
those out.
I'll
have to watch that. I like good content generators. I mean, that's why I'm a Kevin Smith fan. Like, we don't really have to talk about anything. Just enjoy hearing them talk.
Exactly.
You know? Yeah. I didn't care for the new hack and slash at all. You know, they had that way that they would talk over each other and they would spend 5 minutes saying something that could be done in half a minute, you know, and it was kind of their niche. And now they're talking in almost complete sentences and they're not really talking over each other. I don't know. Maybe it'll grow on me, but when it first happened, I was very disappointed in it.
Fair enough.
So I wasn't sure what you thought about that.
Yeah, they definitely have a bigger role in this episode than we've ever seen before. I don't know if they continue to after these episodes, but I don't know. They're there for comic relief in almost entirely. So
Yeah, you're probably right. But
we get a couple of good continuity bits of information this episode.
Fantastic of information.
Yeah, specifically that the Nulls used to be sprites, and that's what happens to them when they're in a game and they lose. They get nullified and become the little wormy things.
Now, this is the first time we've heard about that, right? Because I don't remember hearing that before.
Yeah, I don't think it's explicitly said before. It's kind of hinted at, especially with the words nullified and null being the same word, but it's not something that you'd necessarily pick up on because I don't think they're ever used in the same sentence or maybe even the same episode prior to this. So
I find it interesting that they used to be sprites or binomes and then they become nulls, and then Hexadecimal has some mysterious power over them. That's just interesting. I think we might be able to figure that out as this time goes on. Maybe I don't remember that, but
yeah, there's some nuggets in this episode that will definitely get explained later, like when Megabyte calls the Null Nibbles his father.
Oh yeah, that's creepy. I'm not gonna lie. especially since we've seen Megabyte petting Nibbles a couple times, that just the whole thought process was weird, but yeah.
One really big thing that we've never really touched on is the use of the word sprite to explain the humanoid creatures or characters, and that's actually a term that they use for like the images of characters during video games. They're called the game sprites. So if you're playing like Sonic the Hedgehog, the Sonic that you see on the screen is the Sonic game sprite.
And that's a real world term?
That's a real world term.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it makes sense. It's just, I don't know why we haven't touched on it before. I don't think I'd really, you know, acknowledge that it was true before. But
yeah, I didn't know that. What did you think of Hexadecimal after the creature took it over?
I thought she looked creepy.
Even more creepy.
Yeah, even more creepy. She looked like Venom from the Spider-Man series and comics.
Which I think Venom is always an interesting concept because it's Venom as himself, and then he, you know, consumes Spider-Man. It's the same with Hexadecimal. And the problem, of course, is Hexadecimal is arguably a little more powerful than Spider-Man. So, I mean, it's dangerous.
Yeah.
But, thank goodness for the Nulls.
Yeah. Trying to trap him. And the Disruptomatic, which was in a case that said, in case of giant Null monster, break glass.
I actually had to pause while I was watching this and because I was laughing so hard because I thought that was fantastic. Because it just came off of a line, which is one of my favorite lines, of when Fong is like, you know, I prepared for this. And Bob's like, how did you plan for that? And Fong was like, well, a lucky guess, you know. And then we go down and we see this disruptomatic, you know, break glass. And I'm like, oh, God, that's fantastic. What did you think of the Power Rangers cliche here?
I kind of enjoyed it. They didn't do it too much. Like, they hinted at it, but they didn't kind of sledgehammer us with it, which I thought was a good choice. I did like that the grasshopper line where Enzo pops up because he's the grasshopper animal, is his animal. And Fong's like, oh, there you are, grasshopper.
That was pretty good.
Which that line comes from, what line was it? A television series called Kung Fu. But
very creative name.
Yeah. I wonder what it's about. it's a term that's parodied way too much, but I think it was done really well here.
Yeah, I didn't even know that it had an origin. It's a word that's parodied so much. You know what I mean? Like, it just talks so often. Actually, I put a little note. Is that from The Karate Kid? Like, I didn't think it was, but it just had such a feeling of that kind of kung fu type atmosphere, so I thought maybe it was, but of course it wasn't. Yeah.
And then Mike the TV, of course, is a gnat, and he's like, gnat, what is a gnat? And Dot's like, I don't know, but it seems fitting.
Which was perfect. I mean, that was really good. I enjoyed the fact that Mike the TV was part of this powerful robot fighting off the Nullzilla, I should say. I'm going to have to disagree with you a little bit on the not being a sledgehammer reference to the Power Rangers, because not only did they have separate themed vehicles that came together to make a giant robot that had, you know, disruptomatic or the sword, but they also did the reboot, like, well, the Power Rangers slash reboot moment when they all formed into their vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought that was really good, though, actually, because Frisket, when they got to Frisket, instead of saying, like, Reboot 2 or whatever they, you know, what everyone else was saying, he just goes, woof, woof, woof. Like he had to say that or something. It was really funny.
Yeah. Just the note that Bob was a black beetle, Dot was a lady beetle, a ladybug, and Frisket was a bumblebee. I'm not sure if that one's fitting, but okay.
Well, I mean, after you assign Mike the annoying gnat and Enzo the grasshopper, there's really some movement there. You can do whatever you need to.
Yeah.
Did they call it something? The giant robot? Did they give it a name? I can't remember.
I don't know.
When they were fighting Nullzilla before they got the Disruptomatic, it just really reminded me of all the cartoons when you're trying to fight Clayface, you know, because you can punch him and he'll absorb it, and you can knock him down and he'll come back like a Weeble Wobble. So, you know, that just kind of reminded me of that. I did like how whoever was talking from the robot, they changed how he moved. Did you notice that?
I did not, but that's really neat.
Yeah, like when Dot was talking, all of a sudden his hand was on his hip, you know, and he had that kind of attitude about him and stuff. So I thought that was a really nice touch by the animators, I think.
Yeah, I'm going to have to go back and watch that again.
So what do you think about the fact that Enzo has not yet told Andrea that he's not a guardian?
I don't think it has much to do with this episode. Like, I don't think there's really any stake in it at this point, but as we see later on in this podcast, it will come back to bite him almost.
Yeah, that's true. We should probably postpone that discussion. The only other Bob did say stay frosty. I thought, you know, I got pretty excited about that. At one point he said, you know, what in the nets, you know, which is just another kind of reboot phrase that I enjoyed. But I didn't have any other quotes or references, unless you did.
I had a couple. One point, Bob's like trying to explain something really complex, and then Enzo's just like, what he means is the game that nullified the sprite can also bring it back. And Bob's like, that's what I said. And Andrea's just simply, he said it better.
Yeah, that was good. I forgot about that. Well, now that she's kind of a main cast character, you know, it's good that they have that back and forth.
Yeah, again. Exactly.
I actually forgot about, there was a small throwaway line where Slash says, I don't like L.A.
Yeah.
That's a reference to Randy Newman's song, I Love L.A., which is not overtly awesome, but it just reminded me of Randy Newman's song, I Don't Like Short People. And that made me happy. Have you seen that?
No.
Yeah, he has a whole song about how short people shouldn't be allowed to live, and they get, they're annoying and creepy, basically. And that's the whole song. You should look at it sometime.
Another random reference. Fong's password is FAB, and that's from a show called Thundercats Are Go.
I've never seen that, have you?
Or Thunderbirds Are Go, I'm sorry. No, I don't think I've ever seen that movie.
I don't think so either. But there was a show that was like an old show that I used to watch. It was Thunder something. Maybe it was Thundercats. I don't know.
I think there was a Thunderbirds show.
Okay. It was a long time ago. Did you catch the Alice in Wonderland reference?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's pretty obvious. There's the creature that infects Hex comes out of her looking glass.
Exactly, and I think Mike even said there's something that comes out of Looking Glass, and it wasn't Alice. Like, yeah. I mean, that, you know, I thought that was pretty good, too.
What's wrong?
Do you not hear it?
Hear what? What are you talking about?
Look, Dot, Frisky can hear it, too.
Glitch, scanner. These readings don't make any sense. Wait, the signal's getting stronger.
They're going crazy. They're trying to get out.
Fong?
Very strange. The signal is being emitted from lost angles.
Megabyte.
Hexadecimal, Bob.
What? Right, hexadecimal. Did I say megabyte?
So, Dan, what did you think of episode 7, Nullzilla?
Like I said, it wasn't great on any front, but there were some pretty decent references, some pretty fun moments. I'd have to give it 5 Disruptomatics.
Yeah, I was going back and forth on how low I was going to give this. It's really hard to give a really low score to almost any episode of Reboot, because even if it's a bad episode, quote-unquote bad episode, it always has some really good references. I'm going to give it 4 horrible cliche Power Ranger references. So that's what I'm going to do. Dan, do you want to take us away for episode 8, Gigabyte?
Absolutely.
I am Guardian 452. State your name and function.
I am become Gigabyte, destroyer of systems.
Not this system, Bob. Glitch! Wide field energy beam!
Episode 2.08 is titled Gigabyte. It originally aired December 27th, 1995, the same day as the previous episode. Must have done a little mini marathon type thing.
I guess so, yeah.
Story, and it was written by Phil Mitchell and Susan Turner. The summary is, the entity that escaped Hex's looking glass attacks Megabyte, turning him into a rabid virus that merges with Hexadecimal to create Gigabyte, the next generation of virus. Hacker Mouse arrives as reinforcement and bumps heads with Dot. So, Joey, what'd you think of Gigabyte?
I thought this was better than Nullzilla, which is weird because when I stack up Megabyte and Hexadecimal, I'm a huge Hexadecimal fan. But in this aspect, I liked Gigabyte more than Nullzilla for a couple different reasons. But it was really good. What about you, Dan?
I agree that it was better. And I think why it was better is that instead of a giant blob monster, we actually get a creature that's interesting.
Yeah, like an actual character.
Yeah.
Let's start with just the title as Gigabyte. I had a thought process afterwards how interesting that title is. Because I would sure that outside of the, you know, really tech-savvy people in the 90s, no one had any idea what a gigabyte was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that is just a really, like, niche title. And then, you know, now we're looking back at it, we're all talking, how many gigabytes is your phone, you know, all that kind of stuff. But it's then no one would have had any idea what it was.
Yeah, and for anybody who doesn't know what a gigabyte is, it's a sizable, it's a unit of measurement for computer data that's one step above a megabyte.
Well, it's 1,000 steps above a megabyte.
Well, it's 1,000 megabytes, but, you know, it's one step. I don't know. One commonly used term step above megabyte.
I hear you. But yeah, I just thought that was cool.
Yeah, I think the strongest part about the previous episode, Nullzilla, is that it set up for this episode. And that
I agree.
At the very end, the venom thing that infected Hex now infected Megabyte. And then we begin this episode.
Yeah, I thought it was pretty good. As we get into it, the Gigabyte itself, the character, let's just talk about him. What'd you think?
I think the design was really awesome. It's got, you know, a perfect mixture of Megabyte and Hexadecimal's characteristics.
Mm-hmm.
And so it looked like, you know, it was a mix of them. I mean, it was fantastic.
Yeah. I'm going to take a little detour, as I generally do. It reminded me of an episode of Star Trek Voyager called Tuvix, where it took a guy named Tuvok, who was a Vulcan, and another guy named Neelix, and they had like a transporter accident, and it combined them to create a whole different entity. And, you know, because that's what happened here, Hexadecimal and Megabyte came together. And it was interesting because most people agreed that one character of Tuvix was actually better than the two separate characters. And I think that's kind of similar here too, where Gigabyte, you know, Megabyte and Hexadecimal are both formidable characters, but when you put them together, you have this incredible, I think they even classified it as a class 5 virus, Gigabyte, that's a little bit more effective, maybe.
Yeah, I really enjoyed him in this episode. However, if they had kept him around, I don't think he would have lasted very long as being a good character.
Yeah, well, he's not cunning. You know, he's just extremely powerful.
Yeah.
So, I did notice, and maybe this is just me, but I noticed that Fong says my son a lot, and I just feel like he's really, and I that might just be that they're trying to add to him as a character, but it could just be, too, that Fong is really starting to care for Bob more so than just that he's a guardian, which is sad, obviously, coming up, but... I just think that, you know, maybe I'm looking a little too much into it, but I think Fong is finally starting to care for him as a person, too.
Yeah. This episode is the first time we get Bob's formal designation as Guardian 452.
Yeah, that was pretty cool.
Which, yeah, it doesn't really have any stakes anywhere, but it's cool.
I just wanted to go after the fact that, you know, you've got this brother virus and the sister virus, and when combined, they create a single string, a new string of virus. And to me, that sounds like they are coupling almost, and it just was kind of weird, I think.
Yeah. I don't know. It's kind of weird, but not really. If you overthink it, it's definitely a lot weirder. But I think this is the first episode that we mentioned that they are actually siblings.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, that's
previously,
kind of important to notice.
We learned that they were related, but now we know they're siblings, so that's cool.
Yeah, that is cool. I like that. Because, I mean, we talked about it before. They're polar opposites, you know, chaos and control, and it's just perfect that they're brother and sister. What did you think of the little moment that Dot and Bob have?
I'm not sure which moment you're talking about.
That was after Gigabyte had, like, cornered them, and Bob gave away a glitch so that he can't consume the power or anything like that. Bob looks at Dot and goes, Dot, I want to tell you, like, you know, it's going to give this, you know, I love you kind of phrase. And Dot's like, I know. And then that's when Mouse enters. So
yeah, Mouse. I love Mouse. Yeah, that is a great moment for them and perfectly interrupted by Mouse.
Exactly. And it's perfect that it is Mouse specifically. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because we know that Mouse and Bob have had some sort of history, but we really don't know anything about it.
Yeah, it's all mystery. I don't know if we actually ever get to find out exactly what happens. But
I think we learn some stuff, but not quite everything.
Okay.
One thing I noticed about Mouse is she has tattoos around her eyes and on her shoulder.
Are those tattoos? I wasn't sure.
I'm assuming they're tattoos. I don't know. There's some sort of design there, which I had never noticed before.
That's only the second time we've seen her, so.
Yeah. Probably because of the upgrade in graphics during this season is my
guess.
Yeah,
that's definitely possible.
So it was just an interesting moment where I looked at it. I was like, huh, were those there before? So now I really want to go back and take a look at the previous one and see if she has them there.
I think it was cool. Like, maybe we can get into some of the tactics and how they decided to beat Gigabyte, because he was far more powerful than anything they had. So there's no way that they could just, you know, have a standoff fight.
Yeah.
And he consumed all energy. So it's not like you could even use a lot of CPUs to attack him or anything like that, because he would just consume the energy. So they had to be pretty creative.
Yeah, I really liked their tactics. At one point, he absorbs a binome, dresses Indiana Jones, which I thought was funny.
Yeah, I actually thought that was a Megabyte agent, and then I read that it was Indiana Jones and I had to go back, and I was like, oh, well, I'm an idiot. But
but yeah, they power down the whole city so that he can't absorb everything. They secure a tear, which is really cool, where Dot and Mouse fly out to the ocean, or whatever you want to call it, and Mouse uses a PlayStation controller.
Yeah.
And they kind of trap the tear and bring that energy back to hit Gigabyte with. They use hack and slash to help distract him. I thought that was pretty awesome. And the coolest tactic that they used was they ejected a sector from Mainframe. Floating Points Park.
That.
Right?
Now, do you think it's just Floating Points Park that can be ejected? Or
no,
can you eject,
I mean,
all the parts?
The fact that they can do that tells me that they can do that with all of them. Because why would it just be one?
Yeah, no, I thought that was really cool. And really, this whole episode, well, towards the end of it, you had just unlikely pairs or combinations. You know, you had Dot and Mouse working together, and obviously they have disagreements, and a lot of it is centered around their relationship to Bob. And then you had Bob working with Hack and Slash, you know, so I just thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, a lot of fun in this episode. When Gigabyte first appears, his stance is similar to the T-800 in the Terminator movie.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, great little homage there. Not too overbearing, but pretty sweet.
Yeah, I like that. I like the Terminator movies. I just watched them recently, actually. They were on TV, on Spike, I think. But,
nice.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I'm going to ask you now, because at the end, after they get the tear, you know, Bob is able to separate them back into hexadecimal and megabyte. So effectively, Bob, who's charged with saving all citizens as much as possible and goes out of his way to save Megabyte in the past, you know, when he didn't have to, killed an entity, Gigabyte.
Essentially. I mean, philosophically, yeah, you can argue that, but, I mean, it's still a kid's show. He didn't really destroy an entity so much as create three others.
Well, I mean, three others, that's kind of important. But I don't know. I just thought it was interesting because he seems so hell-bent on trying to protect everyone. He didn't even blink when taking that out. But that came from the episode 2 Vix from Star Trek, so I was probably being a little more deep than that. But just want to let you know.
Yeah, it's a good thought to bring up. I don't think it applies as well here as it would in the Star Trek episode. But
I know it didn't, but I was just curious to see what you were going to say. Fair enough. But at the end, they did make a Shakespeare reference, which I thought was pretty cool. They said there's something rotten in the heart of Mainframe, which is, you know, obviously a quote from Hamlet at the end. You know, nice. Something's rotten in Denmark, I believe it was.
Yep, good catch there. Didn't even notice that one. As a theater major, my professors would probably be really disappointed in me, but I also don't like Hamlet. So
I liked Hamlet. I hated the one where everybody dies at the end. What was that?
All of his tragedies?
Well, yes. Macbeth. I didn't care for Macbeth, but I liked Hamlet. I thought it was good.
Alrighty. One quote. Gigabyte says, "I am become Gigabyte, the destroyer of systems," which is apparently from Vishnu's line from Hindu Bhagavad Gita, which is a book.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure it's a book for the Hindu religion. But okay. The quote is made more famous by Robert Oppenheimer after he's the one of the people who created the atomic bomb. So after
the lead physicist.
Yeah, after the first bomb exploded, he said, "I have become death. I am become death, destroyer of worlds."
That makes more sense because it seemed very. I didn't think about Oppenheimer, but I knew that was the reference to something. And when I looked it up, and they gave me this Vishu stuff, and I'm like, I would never have heard that before. I must have heard it somewhere else.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's where I heard it from.
Yeah, the Bhagavad Gita is the kind of a Bible for the Hindu religion. So.
Okay, I did do a little research, and I wasn't sure, so it seemed complicated to me.
I'm sure relating it to the Bible is not at all accurate, but, you know, it works for our purposes.
Yeah, now we're going to get angry emails. You know, we get our first good email,
Going
to get a bunch of angry emails.
If you are Hindu and take offense to that, please send us an email, and we will retract our statements and fix everything for you.
Yes, and also kind of explain what it is, because it's a little complicated, so I'm okay with that. I don't have any more references or quotes. Do you?
I have one more quote. It's between Dot and Mouse. One of them says, "Hope this works," and the other says, "Well, it was Bob's idea," and then they reply, "That's what I'm afraid of."
Well, that's true, because that's a good bonding moment for them, because a lot of their relationship is tied to Bob, like I said before. So if they can make fun of him, then they can, you know, compare each other. Oh, I did write down that I wish that we could have seen Frisket's fight.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
we didn't get to see Frisket confront Gigabyte and then flashes away and then comes back and Frisket has been absorbed. It was sad.
It was really sad.
So. The reason we didn't see it is it probably would have taken a really long time, and so just cut it out for time purposes.
Yeah, in all reality, you know that Frisket would have battled for at least 10 minutes before he went down, so that you're right, they probably just saved it that way we don't have to see Frisket actually get hurt, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah.
I hope this works.
Well, it was Bob's idea. That's what I'm afraid of.
So, Joey, what did you think of this episode, Gigabyte?
I thought it was much better than Nullzilla. So I'm going to give it 6 dot winks, which I think is appropriate because I gave another episode a mouse wink, so now I have a dot wink.
Nice. Well done.
Thank you.
I really enjoy this one. There's a lot of great stuff in it, a lot of great references. One I think we missed is there's a scene where Gigabyte's dragging his claws across a wall, kind of similar to Freddy Krueger in Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yes.
Good stuff there. A lot of good character moments between characters, like the team-ups that you mentioned. And, yeah. Good introduction to a new character and good continuation into the next episode by having the third entity come out of Gigabyte. So I'm going to have to give it 8 solid state modes.
Oh, that was good. That was very good. Do you want to move into Trust No One?
Yeah, go ahead.
I can't accept that. Mouse is an old friend.
Bob, you've got to be reasonable about this. All evidence points to Mouse. We have eyewitnesses who will testify to her being on or near the scene of each abduction.
Coincidence.
Tell them your theory, Modem.
Her fangs.
Yeah, so? She's got fangs.
I suspect she's a web creature.
What? Oh, now this is ridiculous. These aren't theories. These are delusions.
Listen. When I was just a little node, I saw my sister taken by a strange creature. And it had fangs. Just like Mouse.
Excuse me, but is your partner completely random?
Not completely.
Okay, why didn't it take you too then?
I don't know. I was reading comic bites in bed. When I peeked out from under the covers, I saw something hovering over my sister. Then I pointed my flashlight at it, and a moment later, it and my sister were gone. I'll never forget the noise it made.
I don't want to seem insensitive, but next you'll be telling me that you've seen the user.
There is no user. That's just induced mass psychosis engineered by the Guardians.
What? But what about the games?
Sent by the Guardians to promote the user myth.
Another conspiracy theory, Modem?
One of many.
All right, so we're going to move into episode 2.9, Trust No One. The original air date was January 25th, 1996. So you can see, you know, there's a good month there in between episodes. This was written by Mark Learon Young. The story was by Gavin Blair, Mark Learon Young, Phil Mitchell, Ian Pearson, and Susan Turner. Bob is on the case when a string of abductions claim Aleswader and Dot. Special CGI agents Fax Modem and Data Nully arrived to investigate, and they identify Mouse as the primary suspect. We got a couple first appearances. We got Miss Brody. She's the Enzo and Andrea's teacher. We got the roller skating waiter at Annals. This was a unique title sequence, which I think we'll talk more about in the future. We have Turbo. He is, I guess, the prime guardian. Fax Modem, Data Nully. We get to see the web for the first time and kind of what's coming out of the web. So, Dan, what did you think?
I really enjoyed this episode. There was a lot of great stuff in it. Specifically,
I actually have 2 full pages of notes.
Yeah, I don't have a lot of notes because I was so entranced with the episode.
That's actually probably true, too. Yeah, I mean, it was just good storyline all the way around.
Yeah, and, I mean, anyone who's seen The X-Files knows that Fax Modem and Data Nully sounds like Fox Mulder and Data and Scully.
Yes.
Which are the two FBI agents in that series.
Have you seen X-Files?
I watched a few episodes trying to get into it and kind of fell out of that. But what I've seen is pretty interesting.
My dad used to watch the X-Files, so I'm aware of the show and I got most of the references. But I have never actually like sat down and watched an episode. It's on my list of things to do because people talk about it so much.
Yeah. So yeah, they're part of the FBI in that series, and their reboot counterparts are part of the CGI, which is the reboot version of the FBI. But it's a play on the CGI term computer generated image.
Which, you know, we talk about CGI all the time now. You know, just in our common, there's so many movies that are CGI and everything. So that's, again, another thing that I don't think a lot of people would have gotten back in the day that we can understand now.
Yeah. The most interesting part of this episode is that Dana Nolly is actually voiced by the actress who played Dana Scully.
Which is Gillian Anderson. I mean, how awesome is that?
During one of the interviews that I was watching, they said that she was actually a real big fan of the show, and they were filming, I think they filmed up in Vancouver, which is where this show was produced. And so she came in to like kind of tour the system or area office, and they were like, "Want to do an episode?" And she was like, "Yeah." And so they made a parody, and then the guy who played Fox Mulder didn't want to be a part of it, so they kind of toned his character down and made him kind of a really obnoxious version of the character.
Yeah, which, you know, it was a good ploy on them, but it annoyed me that he didn't want to be a part of it since she was doing it. Now, isn't she was married to one of the creators or something too, right? I think I remember reading that somewhere.
That could be. I didn't come across that, but
she's married to someone that had a connection with the show as well. I just can't remember which one that was. But, I mean, the whole episode, it's not just that they have these two agents that remind us of the X-Files. The whole episode is an X-File-themed episode.
Yeah, I mean, it starts off with the dark opening where we see one of the waiters gets kidnapped, and then the title scene is just "Trust No One" in the kind of a similar font to the X-Files show. I'm assuming.
Yeah, and yeah. Well, actually, I'm not sure about that, but it should be a reference to something because it was obviously different.
Yeah.
But yeah, just the trust no one is just a good theme of the show in general. They were always meeting people and thought that they were allies and found out they weren't. So that's where trust no one. It was just perfect.
Yeah.
I thought the show itself was kind of, I mean, because they were taking an X-Files look at it, it was kind of scary. I mean, being a little kid, this episode could be pretty scary.
Yeah, I mean, it's the darkest episode to date, I believe.
I mean, it was intense. I mean, at one point you even see Mike the TV get abducted, and then it moves off screen, and you hear him yell, and you see a bunch of lights, and they're going back and forth, and I mean, it was a scary scene, I think.
Yeah, I liked the misdirect that kind of implied at the beginning that Mouse was the one abducting people.
Yes.
And I thought that was really cool and definitely an homage to X-Files, because there was a lot of misdirect in that.
And it was good too, because, you know, and I didn't think it was actually Mouse, but I thought maybe Mouse had been taken over or something.
Yeah, I kind of felt that way too.
Yeah. Feel that Mouse was the actual person, thought that she was doing it somehow. I thought this is the moment when they take Mike out, and you know they're going after him. That whole scene, it obviously it's a kid's show, so they weren't going to be able to actually like be it. You know, there's certain can't put on a kid's show.
I just remember listening to a podcast one time about Batman the Animated Series that Kevin Smith was talking about, and it was the episode where you see Dick Grayson's parents get killed by the mobster. Do you remember this?
I remember that podcast, yeah.
Yeah, and they couldn't show the mobster actually cut the line because that would be showing the mobster killing these people. So what they had to do is they had to swing out, they had to scream, then all you saw was the rope come back, cut. And because of that, I think that scene is imprinted on our brains more because it was a little more unique, especially for a little kid. And I think the same thing with the TV. You can't see him get attacked, but you can see all the energy being drained out. I just thought it was really cool.
Yeah, it's a great, great moment of less is more. Kind of like the happy accident that was Jaws, in that their mechanical jaws wouldn't work until a lot later in the production. So there was originally supposed to be a lot more seeing the shark in that movie. But because you don't see the shark, it's that much more powerful.
You know, I've never seen Jaws.
Really?
No, never have.
Crazy.
Yeah. I didn't know about that either.
Huh. Interesting.
Let's talk about the creature, the web crawler. What'd you think of him? Her, I guess.
I think it was pretty creepy. I don't know if I really liked the design. I think the head was too big for the rest of the body. I don't think it looked balanced or normal or legit, really.
Yeah, it seemed a little odd, like it wouldn't be able to actually be real, but I mean, I guess in the context of what we're talking about, it's a little ridiculous. But I mean, it was scary. It certainly was. I don't see how no guardian had never been able to see it before, because it's really big and bulky.
Yeah.
So it didn't really make a whole lot of sense to me. And that was another thing where, you know, we'll have to get into talking about Turbo in a minute, but you know, the guardian code to dealing with web crawlers is to explode that area, you know, just have it all destroyed. And I feel like that's kind of premature, since you could hold it with a flashlight.
Yeah.
Like, that's kind of a lot of people that you were ordering killed.
Yeah, I do like that Turbo gives him an extra turn of the hourglass in order to help out Bob, since they've got a past.
Which I hope we get to see more of Turbo and other Guardians later, because I think that is really cool, the idea that he has this boss, you know, and they have a past, and yeah, I thought that whole aspect was really cool.
Yeah, I know we get some more Turbo. I don't know how much, though.
Okay, that's good. I thought it was interesting how Mouse, who's tracking this web crawler, finds all these binomes and sprites that are being drained of their energy, and she walks past all of them to get to Dot right away. And I was just curious, as your thought, would Bob find Dot first and then rescue everybody, or would he rescue them all, like, step by step?
I bet he would find Dot first.
My first thought process is that he wouldn't have, but then the more I thought about it, he probably would, because then she'd be able to help with the binomes.
Exactly.
Yeah. The whole ending with Bob running the bomb to the top of Mainframe, that's very reminiscent of last summer's movies. You know, you had Batman run away with a nuclear bomb. Yeah. You had Iron Man do the exact same thing. It just a very dramatic ending.
Yeah. I think this one did it a lot better, mostly because it hadn't been done nearly as much at the time. So it kind of just, the originality of it seemed more, it seemed better.
I agree.
I liked Fax Modem's conspiracy theories and all that stuff. Like, he's like, the user doesn't exist.
Which was awesome.
Yeah, and kind of mocking the Fox Mulder character again.
Yeah, which was perfect.
Yeah. And one of my favorite quotes comes from him when he's talking about how his sister got abducted by aliens or something. And they were like, why didn't they take you? And he's like, I don't know. I was reading Comic Bites at the time.
Oh, God, that is pretty good. He had a couple good ones. He also had the, he said something like, you're right, it can't stand the strong light. There's probably a scientific reason for that.
Yeah, I'm sure there's a very scientific reason for it.
Yes, I thought that was really good.
It's just, you know, great line to say, yeah, we're not going to explain this, but it probably makes sense.
Which is a lot of those shows. Yeah. You get that a lot in Star Trek and stuff. They'll just, like, make up some scientific principle just to solve, you know, for the storyline. But
yeah, I like that approach better than the techno babble for this episode, at least.
Oh, I agree. Someone, and I didn't write down who, but somebody said the web is out there.
Yeah, that was either Fax or Dana.
I thought it was. Which, of course, is the whole point of X-Files. The truth is out there. Mm-hmm. So that was really cool.
Yeah, so good episode. I enjoyed it.
First on-screen kiss.
Yeah. I don't know. Remember who it was between.
It was Mouse and Bob.
That's right.
Yeah. I mean, aww, I think there's gonna be some consequences because of that. Well, I guess not, but again,
maybe not given the next episode.
I keep saying that. I'm like, oh, crap.
Yeah. Oh, so,
something specific. The whole scene in the beginning, I meant to mention with Cecil, when he was saying he was in charge and Bob called him Cecil. And I wrote down on my paper, I was like, I thought it was Cecil. Dan was wrong. And then, you know, Cecil comes back and he goes, oh, and it's Cecil, you know. So I just thought that was pretty appropriate since the last episode you corrected me on how to name his name. And then this episode they actually addressed it as well.
Yeah. I feel like he says that once a season at least. No, it's Cecil.
Yeah, well, I forgot about that. I don't remember it ever happening before, so I thought that was pretty good.
Okay, one last thing before we get into scores. The milk carton that Mike shows with the missing number 5 on it, because 5 got abducted, has milk and the French word late, which is French for milk.
Yeah.
Which makes sense.
Yeah, because it's Canadian, and they have a lot of French words. And even though the per capita amount of people who speak French in Canada isn't that large, they just try and respect the Quebec region, and they do that. I mean, I grew up thinking napkins were called serviettes, because that's what my Nana called them.
Nice.
So.
You were right. It can't stand the strong light.
Sure, there's a very scientific reason for it.
But we don't know what it is.
So, Dan, what did you think of this episode?
I enjoyed it. It was a lot of fun. Great homage to X-Files. Makes me want to go watch some more of that show. It's darker. It's getting really dark for this show, which only continues. And I think it's a great choice. So, I will give it 8.5 CGI agents.
Oh, no, very nice. I'm going to agree with you. I think this episode was great. I like the fact that it was dark. I like the fact that it was the whole episode was an X-Files discussion. I like the fact that we brought in this new character, Turbo, that I think we're going to hear a little bit more about later. You know, Mouse was there. It was just good on all. So I'm gonna give it 8 dramatic kisses.
Nice.
Thank you. Dan, you want to take us into Web World Wars?
It's sad that something so beautiful could be so deadly.
It must be really bad. I've never seen Bob team up with Mega Breath and Hexadismal like this before.
Where I come from, it's very simple. If you see an enemy, you destroy him. Here, you seem to form a team and make plans. You Guardians are too clever for me.
Andrea? There's something I've been meaning to tell you. You know how I said I was a Guardian? Well...
Cadet Matrix?
Bob?
Why aren't you in uniform? You know how serious things are. It's time you got suited up.
What?
Just follow me on this one. Due to the current crisis we're all facing, I am invoking emergency code 9510. Enzo, give me your icon.
Okay.
Command line, icon, download Guardian Protocol to version 1.0. Enzo Matrix, there is a huge responsibility in taking the Guardian badge of office. Do you accept?
Yes, sir!
By the power vested in me, I give you a field commission as Guardian, first level. You've really earned this. You'll be transferred to the supercomputer to attend the academy and become a full-fledged Guardian like me. I know you'll make me proud.
Bob, we're at the tour. Megabyte, Mouse, Hexadecimal, and I are ready to go. I can't believe I just said that.
Okay, let's do it. Guardian Enzo?
Yes, sir?
This is it. Should anything happen to me, I am charging you with defense of this system. And look after him, will you?
Episode 210. Air date originally aired on February 1st, 1996. Written by Mark Lyron Young, and stories by Mark Lyron Young, Brandon McCarthy, Phil Mitchell, Ian Pearson, and Susan Turner. Summary is Bob, Dot, and Mouse must team up with Megabyte and Hexadecimal to save Mainframe from the attacking web. Their attempt to close the portal to Mainframe ends with Bob being shot into the web. We have first appearances of Guardian Enzo, also Enzo without a hat, and Megaframe. So, Joey, what do you think of this episode?
I really enjoyed how Identity Crisis ended the first season, but it is nothing to compare how the Web World Wars ended the second season. It is just phenomenal in so many ways. I don't even know really where to start.
Well, overall, the story isn't very powerful. It's just... This episode, to me, is mostly a lot of fighting, a lot of really cool fighting, a lot of dogfights, kind of reminded me a lot of Star Wars.
Yeah, oh, especially the sounds. When you mm-hmm. hear just aerial fights in general are really awesome, and then we've had a couple of them, but nothing to the extent that we've had so far. Like, on this episode, it's been amazing. And I think they actually put in some of those little zoom that just reminded you of Star Wars.
Yeah, like I was watching that and I was like, is this Star Wars? And they're like flying around the principal office, which is, you know, a big sphere like the Death Star.
Yeah, oh, that's true. I didn't even catch that, really. That's funny.
Yeah, good episode. Some references are like Piccadilly Circuits is painted on a wall in a subway kind of station, and that is a reference to World War II, where Piccadilly Circus in London is where people were hiding during some bombings.
Which is extremely appropriate at this point, because if you're not a biome in a CPU, then you're kind of worthless and you're just going to get in the way. So
yeah,
let's go hide.
We get some Binky and Algernon moments, which are great.
I have Algernon and Binky. We are saved, you know, because they're here. They're on the case.
Yeah, nice. So yeah, we've got them working together with Hexadecimal and Megabyte, and of course, you know, they get betrayed by Hexadecimal and Megabyte.
Yeah, that was so clear what was going to happen.
Yeah, I just thought it was really cool how the writers of the episode had everybody work together. I don't feel like it was very forced. It all made sense. You know, you had Megabyte, who had that infrastructure and the intelligence to create the hardware, that big gun. And then you have Hexadecimal, who has unlimited power, and she's able to charge it. And then Fong had to give Megabyte the software. And, you know, Mouse is able to hack into the web, you know, so they can use the hardware. And it just seemed to all really work well together.
Yeah, I totally agree. It felt fluid, like everything flowed perfectly. Yeah, it was just a good episode. There's not a ton to say about it, I don't think, until we get to the very end where, you know, Bob gets sent through into the web.
There's a couple good references, a couple good lines. I thought, and there was that one moment I wanted to ask you about. This is probably one of those things where I write down and then it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. But when Megabyte is talking to Mouse, he like gets over her and he's like, you know, are you working on this as fast as you can, little girl, or whatever? And it just seemed really awkward, like almost like sexual harassment in the workplace. And I just wasn't sure if you thought Megabyte was hitting on Mouse.
I don't think so, but that's just from a character perspective. Like, that moment I could see being construed as, you know, sexual harassment. But just knowing Megabyte and his vicious intentions, that's probably not his motivation there.
That's fair. I just thought it was interesting.
Yeah, we get Mouse hacking the web. It gets explained later on in a next season episode, I think.
Does it? Okay, because that makes a little more sense, because it just was kind of accepted that she can just hack into the web.
Yeah, a lot of stuff from this batch of season or episodes gets explained next season, because next season, we'll get into this more next episode, but next season is the third season, and it's where the creators really get to go free and do what they want to do with the show.
And it's partly because they are not appearing on a certain network, which, you know, we can talk about.
Yeah, we'll explore that more next episode.
Okay.
So.
I did really like, I think this is going to be my favorite quote of the episode, when Megabyte comes after Mouse and she pulls out her little samurai sword. She's like, one step closer and I'll subdivide you.
Yeah, that was a good one.
I thought that was really good.
My favorite quote of the episode comes from Enzo. When Andrea is like, it's sad that something so beautiful can be so deadly. And Enzo replies, it must be really bad. I've never seen Bob team up with Mega Breath and Hexadismal like this before. Like, so
intensely.
Yeah,
that was great.
I know we've heard Mega Breath before. I don't think we've heard Hexadismal.
I don't think so either.
But I like both of those.
And it just really goes to show, as cool as Enzo is and as capable as Enzo is, he's still like a 12-year-old kid that wants to call people poopy breath and stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's going to end soon, because he kind of has to grow up quite a bit in this episode and this episode.
I didn't realize that this was going to happen at the end, and I remember when Bob was essentially deputizing Enzo, that I was like, does Bob really have time for this? I mean, he's like coordinating this entire mass
army against, you know, the web, and he's coordinating it with Megabyte and Hexadecimal and Fong, and he's going to spend, because I kind of thought he was doing it to to show off to Andrea.
Yeah.
And so I thought it was kind of worthless, but I guess I'm glad he did it.
Yeah, that's the one moment in this episode that at the time it doesn't really feel necessary. It kind of feels forced, but the way the episode ends, it kind of is necessary plot-wise. And it's really just a great moment where, you know, Enzo's getting all serious. He's like, I need to tell you that I'm not a guardian. But before he can get it out, Bob shows up. He's like, you are now deputized Guardian Enzo.
So, yeah, I mean, I guess we've alluded to it. Do you want to talk about that Bob is gone?
Yeah, Bob's gone. The Megabyte actually hatches a plan that works.
Yeah.
Which I think is great. Having him, you know, in a moment of crisis where Bob and Dot, Mouse, and Fong are all kind of focused on saving Mainframe and not really prepared to deal with Megabyte and Hexadecimal, is the one time that Megabyte's plan actually works.
I guess it's because they let their guard down. I mean, Bob should never have let his guard down around Megabyte. I mean, obviously he needed to utilize them. There was no way they'd be able to survive without it. But he let his guard down.
Yep.
And he went. Now, I got to tell you, I mean, I knew it was going to happen at some point. And of course, the show's 20 years old and it's computer animated, but I really felt Enzo's pain. They did a really good job. That whole last minute and a half was very fast.
Yeah. And then Megabyte and Hexadecimal start taking out the CPUs. And at the end, he does a broadcast that ends up saying, "Welcome to Megaframe."
Which is a pretty big plot line for C3.
Yep.
But I thought it was a good episode. I thought overall it was good. I think the good guys lost, you know, and it's mostly their fault. I think it was fairly obvious what Megabyte wanted to do. Not down to the specifics, but, I mean, what can you do? It was a fight. It was a good effort.
Yeah. All around a great episode. But mostly because it's setting up a great season 3.
And I remember more of season 3, but it's always bits and pieces. So I'm pretty excited back into that. I wanted to ask you, because we've had the distinction now with the web, which of course we know what the web is, and we talked about it last episode, web versus nets.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think the supercomputer is? Because they always talk about it, and I kind of associated it with the internet. But
that's
then, of course,
really good
it's separate.
Question.
You know, what is this supercomputer that they talk about?
I'd probably go with something along the lines of the manufacturer of the programs. So kind of like Microsoft.
That would make sense, because that's where I would assume that, well, I mean, I think we know for sure that the Guardian School is, and everything is all at the supercomputer, which makes sense that it would be at the software developer.
That's what I'd go for, barring, you know, actual long thought about it.
Yeah.
The chaps are getting jittery, is that? Well, let's just hope no one cracks Binky. Oh, I see. Stiff upper lip, is it, huh?
So, yeah, what would you rate this episode?
I want to give it 10, but I don't think it quite deserves 10. So I'm going to give it 9 obvious betrayals.
Nice.
Thank you. What about you, Dan?
I'd agree with you that it probably doesn't quite deserve a 10. Especially knowing that next season is going to be upping the ante on everything. I'm going to have to also give it a 9 web probes.
Oh, that's good. Try again.
Hey, Mouse! Join me for an energy shake?
Love to, sugar.
Cecil, two energy shakes, please.
What do you think I am, a waiter? I will have you know that in Madame's absence, I am in charge of this establishment. And for your information, it is Cecil.
Is he always like that?
Always.
Alrighty, let's get into a season recap for season two.
Are you ready for this, Dan?
I think so.
Alright. So I think we're going to probably go with the same formula that we had last time. We'll talk about our least favorite and most favorite main cast. And then we'll do a secondary cast or just any, which includes anyone that pretty much anybody else except for the main cast, even if they were just like one-offs. We'll talk about our favorite and our least favorite episodes, as well as our least favorite and our favorite games. So Dan, let's start with main cast. What are you thinking?
I don't know. This one's tough. I mean, we get introduced to Andrea, and she becomes a great character later on, but she hasn't really done anything yet, so I'm going to pass on her. We get a lot of good hexadecimal episodes this season, specifically Painted Windows. I don't know, though. I wish Mouse was in here more because I really like her, but she'll probably be my favorite secondary. I'm gonna have to go with Megabyte. I think he's done the most this season, and especially in Web World Wars when he actually succeeds and banishes Bob from Mainframe for a long time.
That's fair. And we do realize too. I mean, this is not a one episode fix and Bob is back. I mean, he did a good job at what he was doing. So he does deserve that credit. I was really hard because I'm always a hexadecimal fan, and you're right. Hexadecimal has had some fantastic episodes. Like you said, Painted Windows, most notably, but I think if I remember correctly, I gave, first season, my favorite main cast character was Dot, and the reason I did that is she had the most growth. Like, we learned the most about her. So I kind of thought about using that metric for this one, and the obvious choice for me is Enzo. You know, where you start with Enzo being rather just first of all, I hated Enzo the first time I watched it, in terms of, like, when I was a kid. I just thought he was annoying and always in the way. But I really have started to appreciate him on this rewatch. And then at the end of the second season, he becomes Guardian, mm-hmm. You know, so I want to give him props for that. And I'm going to say that Enzo's my most favorite character, main cast.
Fair enough. I like your reasoning there. And I totally agree that he's grown quite a bit this season, and he'll continue to.
Yeah, I thought about waiting for the third season because there's going to be a lot more going on. But, you know, the actual growth, I think, happens here. And then, you know, he just maybe redefines it in the third and fourth season. So,
yeah.
So what's your least favorite, Dan?
Least favorite. This is always a tough one because it's not like there's an obvious these characters kind of suck as characters.
Right.
They're all pretty good characters. I think that I think that Dot did the least this season. Like, she never seemed to be around or a big part of the story. So I'm gonna go with Dot, I think.
Yeah, it's funny that you say that, because she's also my answer, and for basically the exact same thing. And it's even more funny because she was my favorite character last time. But she didn't do a whole lot. I mean, even in Trust No One, she played the damsel in distress. You know, she wasn't the tough, hardcore Dot that gets stuff done. She just was there. And I think part of that is we brought in Mouse, and she's really hardcore. And I think they're trying to find that medium and how they're going to have them both, which they do eventually. So Dot was by far my least favorite main cast character.
Cool.
What about secondary? Dan, you got any thoughts on your favorite there?
Well, honorable mention goes out to Binky and Algernon. because they're awesome. And definitely Tuke guy, although we didn't see a lot of him. Like, we didn't see him at all this podcast, these four,
no.
last four.
No, we have
which
not.
Which is sad. But a little note about that, one of the interviews I was watching said that there was a band in the area that was called Tuke, and they had those beanies, and that's why, that's where that character comes from.
Really?
Yeah.
See, and that's even cooler now that there's that
exactly.
story with it as well.
I tried to look up their music, but I couldn't find any, which is sad. But yeah, that was a great realization. I was so happy about it.
Especially since we've given him so much, you know, airtime talking about him already.
Yeah, because he's the best.
I agree.
But he's not in enough episodes to justify being the best secondary character.
I agree.
So, same goes with Mouse. She's not around nearly enough.
She's kind of in a bad medium because she's not really a secondary character at this point, but she's not a main cast either.
Yeah, you know, it's like she got main cast for the back half of this season and then kind of
right.
comes in a lot next season.
Right. She'll definitely be main cast next season.
Yeah. I'm going to have to go with Andrea because even though she doesn't do much this season, she's introduced and becomes a great... It's a great introduction to a character. She starts to grow this season, but she'll be a lot better next season.
No, I agree. And I think that was a lot of the same reasons with Enzo. You know, there's just a lot more to come. I kind of had a hard time with this because there's a lot, you know, there's a lot of characters in Reboot. You know, you don't think about it, but we see a lot of characters. And I settled on the Codemaster because I thought that was just a really cool idea. I liked how extremely honorable he was. I liked the way he looked. I liked the way he sounded. I thought it was all really good. And I specifically just remember him, you know. So I thought it was cool.
Nice. Good one.
What about your least favorite?
Least favorite. I don't know. Least favorite. Probably Nullzilla. I mean, it worked for a plot point to get to Gigabyte, but Nullzilla was kind of boring, not a great episode, and the character itself wasn't really a character so much as an object and a boring one.
No, yeah, I agree. I was going to ask you if we can include Nullzilla as it, because I wasn't sure, but it's my answer as well. He was a blob is all it was. So,
alrighty, why don't we get into games? What would you say is your favorite game this season?
You know, and we talked about it earlier. There's not a lot of games in this season. It's a pretty short season, just in general. But my favorite one had to be the ocean game where we first met Andrea. I thought, and I think you mentioned it, that the animation, it was just fantastic. You know, the expression on their faces, even though they're talking telepathically, and I'm talking about Bob and Dot at this point, which was just really good. And the fact that it brought in Andrea made it even better. So I'm going to go with the ocean game. What about you?
Yeah, there's not a ton of games. Notably, we get the Andrea episode with a couple of games in there. We've got a couple games in When Games Collide. And though I really enjoy the flying pterodactyl plane and the Tankosaurus Rex, I don't think the game itself was interesting enough. I liked the story, but the game itself was eh. I'm going to have to go with the game from Bad Bob, the Mad Ooh. Max style game, just because of the pounding beat that just keeps driving the game, and it's just really intense. And we get a tank Megabyte, which is kind of ridiculous, but awesome.
Yeah, no, I agree.
And Fong is in the game.
That's the only time that's ever happened. I mean, so far, anyway.
Yeah.
What about your least favorite games?
Probably the one at the beginning of When Games Collide, where they're just kind of standing there and things are shooting at them. Don't remember what it was called. Something about alien combat or something.
Yeah, and then that's the one where they had the glitch.
Yeah.
That's how they beat it, yeah. I didn't even think about that. I might have chose that. But the one I chose was the game in High Codes. The episode itself was really good. And what Bob had to do to win slash not win that game and then end up winning it because Enzo was in it was really good. But I'm just generally not a huge fan of Western-themed things. I chose that as my least favorite game.
Yeah, that's a good choice, too, because, I mean, they're just riding a train.
Yeah.
It's nothing happens, really.
Yeah, they don't do anything.
Cool. What about favorite episode?
This is really difficult for me. At first I thought Painted Windows, because, and I said this a couple times on that episode, Painted Windows is such a uniquely Reboot episode. You know, it's something that almost I can only think of Reboot doing. And I think it needs to get props. But when Webs Collide, which is the finale, was really good. And I think that Painted Windows story trumps the season finale, I'm going to go with when Webs Collide? No.
World Webs Collide.
World Web Wars. World Web Wars. I knew I was saying it wrong. I'm gonna say that edges out, and that might just be because I just recently watched it. But I'm gonna go with that one. What about you, Dan?
There's a lot of good episodes this season. There, really only two that I wasn't a big fan of. We'll get to that in a moment. It's between Andrea, World Web Wars, and Trust No One. Trust No One mostly because of the great references it has. Andrea and Web World Wars are both up there because of the impact it has on later episodes and later seasons. You know what? I'm going with Andrea. I mean, they've got a lot going on from that episode already, so I'll go with that one.
That's a good choice. I can totally respect that. It was a good episode. It brought in a good character. You know, without it, it would drastically change the third season. So,
exactly. And what would you say your least favorite was?
I'm just hands down Nilzilla. The more I thought about it, the less I enjoyed that episode. That episode of Reboot is still a good episode, but I just didn't care for the episode at all. Didn't really add a whole lot. The only thing that it did was lead us.
And you cut out.
So, yeah, not a fan. Dan?
Definitely Nullzilla is up there. The only one that really gives it any sort of challenge is When Games Collide. Because while it had an interesting twist in that there was a games, the merged game, that's really the only main strong point of that episode. You know what, since you gave it to Nullzilla, I'm going to give it to When Games Collide.
That's fair. That's very fair. But I mean, I think overall, this was a very good season. I think we got to see a lot of good stuff. I mean, we came out of Identity Crisis, which was a really good set of episodes. And I think it just led strong. And it finished strong even. So I'm excited about the third season. I'm excited looking back at what happened in the second season, you know, and I'm excited for the future. So,
yeah, judging by our scores, we rate this season, I've got a 7.6 average, and Joey's down at 7.2.
I know, apparently I hate Reboot.
Yeah.
do you, and I don't know if you have them right there, do you have our scores from last season?
Our scores from last season were... I had an average of 6.7, and Joey had an average of 7.
So, I mean, we're fairly consistent. You went up pretty a lot, actually, yeah, I guess.
I liked this season a lot. A lot. So.
Yeah, I think the third season, you're going to see our numbers go a little higher, too.
Mm-hmm.
But overall, great season, and I can't wait for the third season. Do you have any general thoughts of the second season? Just overview?
I'm glad we got to see a rise in the. I don't know how to explain it. First, definitely an increase in the technology available that made the graphics a lot better and a lot less choppy.
I agree.
But the storytelling takes a leap too. They go out on a limb and start planting ideas for later seasons, and they've got a lot of new introduced characters that become pretty big later on. That there's a lot of darkness towards the end that, I mean, Bob gets sent out into the web for something like 11 episodes, so.
Yeah. I mean, we spent a lot of our individual episodes talking about the different tracking shots, how bright the episodes were, the depth that you see in Mainframe now. I mean, it's just leaps and bounds ahead of first season in terms of just what it looks like. And you're right, the second season, I mean, I think the episode went, they're less episodic, so that was nice.
Mm-hmm.
And the story writing just seemed more developed. So overall, I mean, it was much better than the first season. And first season was good, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I can't wait to move forward. There's a couple things we didn't talk about, that I just think, you know, maybe we should recap. We now know because of second season that, Megabyte and Hexadecimal are brother and sister. You know, that is an awesome, you know, continuation of the storyline. We now know that what nulls are. They were previous binomes and sprites, which is really kind of creepy if you think about it. You know, we know that Old Man Pearson was once a codemaster.
Yeah.
Which I think is fantastic. I almost chose him as my favorite second character, just because it's Old Man Pearson, for crying out loud. You know, there's just a lot of things that the third and fourth season are going to build upon that came out of this season. And if you can think of any more, please chime in. But there's some big ones.
Yeah, we get some touches on Dot's father as well.
Oh, yeah.
And the Twin City, the apparent other city that is now Lost Angles. But we don't find out about that until later.
That's true. We build that up. We build off of that, I guess. You know, we got to see Mouse.
Mm-hmm.
I think
Mouse,
we're starting to kind of
choice.
See her as a character, as not as much of an archetype.
Yeah.
You know, so I mean, so much is the beginning of this this season. It's monumental to the long storyline.
Yep. And we should call it a day because we're already running quite a bit over time. But that's all right, I think. We had a couple more episodes and we had to finish off the season, so.
And I think it's a strong finish, so hopefully people will be interested all the way to the end.
Yeah. If you want to send us some feedback, you could send us your picks of, you know, favorite episode and characters, do so at mainframechronicle@gmail.com. You can find us on Twitter at MFChronicle. We're trying to be a little bit more proactive with that, specifically for one reason, and that is there's a hashtag #BringBackReBoot. And
yeah, I saw that. That's really awesome. Let's make goal to have everybody start hashtagging that.
Yes, if you are on Twitter, definitely follow us at MF Chronicle and use the hashtag #BringBackReBoot. One tweet that has that hashtag is at Michael Heffron from at Rainmaker Entertainment. We'll be talking to at Toonami Podcast about the future of Reboot. Stay frosty in April. Yes. Yes, that's right. They're talking about the future of ReBoot in April.
That's so fantastic. This is the first I've heard of this. So I am ecstatic. I mean, I can't remember, and I should probably know this, but there are a lot of time in between seasons, and between the second and third season and the third and fourth season. So, hey, maybe we can have a fifth one.
Yep. Between second and third season is about a year, maybe a year and a half. And then between season three and season four is 3 years. So,
dude, that's insane.
Yeah. I think it's April 4th that podcast is going up. Then they're talking about the future of ReBoot. I don't know what it entails, but I'm sure we will be talking about it probably next episode. We're not going to be able to record by then, I'm sure. But maybe we'll do a special episode just talking about that, depending on what the news is.
I mean, yeah, if it's really big, I mean, we could dedicate a whole episode to it.
Yep. So
I'm down for that.
We'll be seeing you in a month or so. If you want to check out our other podcasts, you can do so at almppodcasts@blogspot.com. We've got the Cinemasters, which is a movie review podcast, and the Rogue Arrow podcast, which is a review show for the TV show Arrow. You can follow me on Twitter @AmazingBass. That's amazing, BASS.
And you can follow me on Twitter @BabyKangaroo90.
And unless you've got anything else, I think that'll be about it for today.
Yeah, no, I'm good. I'm happy that we had some feedback from a fan.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think we can build off of that. And because of his email, I'm going to try and do a little bit more research every time. It's good to know people are listening to what we're doing, enjoy what we're doing, but we're always willing to modify that. So please, in any of the capacities that Dan just read to you, let us know. You know, I'm up for learning and listening. So.
Yeah, definitely a great big thank you to Carson M. for sending us some emails.
Yeah, Dan actually texted me and he was like, "We got a fan mail," and I immediately went there and I read it, and I was a little more excited about it than I ought to have been. But anyway, thanks, Carson. We appreciate it. We really do.
And as always, I'm Daniel James.
And I'm Joey Morris. Stay frosty, my friends.
Bob! Bob, come in!
He can't hear you, Fong.
Dot! Mouse! Where is Bob? What has happened?
It's bad, Fong. Very bad. I'm sorry.
No! No!
Thank you all for your valiant efforts in fighting the web. Unfortunately,
it was all for nothing. As we speak, your CPUs are being shot out of the sky. Fong, drop all defenses on the principal office and welcome to Mega Frame.
I love it when he talks like that.
We will fight you to the last megabyte.
You have no defenses, you fools. Your guardian is lost. Nothing can stand in our way. Mainframe is ours.
Wrong! We do have a guardian. Guardian, your key tool. Remember what Bob said.
I am Guardian Matrix, charged with defending this system. Two viruses take over my home? I don't think so!
the battling bowman, Ollie. Whatever name you know him by, he is best known as Oliver Queen, the billionaire playboy who was stranded on an island for 5 years, forcing him to become the Arrow. Join us as we follow his journey to clean up the mess his father helped create in Starling City. I am Daniel James.
I'm Chris O'Neill.
I'm Laurel Merz.
And I'm Rudy Schubach.
And you should check out Rogue Arrow Podcast, where we talk about the CW show Arrow. You can find us at roguearrow.blogspot.com or by searching iTunes or Facebook for Rogue Arrow Podcast. The movie game is a game that Rudy and I play where we come up with a starting point and an ending point, and we try to get there using the same rules as 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon, essentially.
More often than not, it just sort of devolves into a vehicle for which you talk about awesome movies. But yeah, that's sort of the bare bone structure from the way I play it.
Yes, so Rudy, what are we going to be starting off with?
We're starting with Drive.
So we're going from Drive to Goldfinger. We're going to connect them somehow. You want to start or you want me to start?
I'll say we got the movie Drive. We're going to Ryan Gosling just because he's the only one who I didn't see it, I guess.
Exactly. Okay, Ryan Gosling was also in The Notebook.
I don't know The Notebook either. Awesome. Wait, who's in that? Someone, Rachel McAdams.
Rachel McAdams, another name I don't know. So maybe Drive is not the best place.
Oh no, I got this one. Okay, Rachel McAdams was in Wedding Crashers.
Wedding Crashers, awesome. That's Vince Vaughn and Owen Wilson. I think I'll go Vince Vaughn. I feel like he's more connected.
Let's go Vince Vaughn to his early work, Swingers.
We'll go Jon Favreau.
So let's go with Jon Favreau to, he was in a bunch of movies recently. He was in, I Love You Man.
Pretty much all the Marvel movies.
He was in specifically Iron Man. And in Iron Man there was, can we go through?
Iron Man and Iron Man 2.
Yeah, so either of the, we can go through either of the guys who played Colonel James Rhodes, or we can go through Robert Downey was in Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. Mm-hmm. With Val Kilmer?
Yeah.
Val Kilmer was in...
Val Kilmer was in Batman Forever.
Which was
Tommy Lee Jones and Jim Carrey.
Tommy Lee Jones. He's got to have been in a movie that we can go through. A lot of people give us crap because they're like, you should be trying to find the shortest route. And it's like, that's not the point. That's not the point.
No, no. I mean, this isn't a great example because we're not stopping and talking about all the movies. But that's what we normally do, and that's usually what this game is played for.
Okay, so we got Tommy Lee Jones. We're going to go Tommy Lee Jones to, what was he? He was in something less modern. We got to start moving backwards. He was in The Fugitive.
Harrison Ford.
Well, that'll get us to Harrison Ford, exactly. Harrison Ford's an older actor, which means he'll be in movies closer to that time period.
Harrison Ford. Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade.
Oh, no. Yes, you're right. He played Indy's father, and there you go. Harrison Ford to Sean Connery through Last Crusade to James Bond, Goldfinger.
Bam. Awesome. Well,
anyway, so that's an example of the movie game. Yay, we made it.
Check out the Cinemasters podcast at thecinemasters.blogspot.com. You can also find us on Facebook by searching for Cinemasters Podcast.